on the phone. It's a pleasure to welcome to the program Dr. David Graeber. He is a teacher at the University of London, an anthropologist and author of Debt, the First 5,000 Years. Welcome to the program, Doctor.
Well, thanks for having me.
Now, I want to get to, obviously, and particularly on a day like today, where there are multiple direct actions going on involving Occupy Wall Street and Occupy other cities. On the West Coast, on the ports, of course, in New York City, at least 17 arrested today following a protest at Goldman Sachs and Brookfield Properties. And I want to get to your perspective on this. I think at least people on this program are well aware of your role in the early organization of Occupy Wall Street. But I've read your book. It's fascinating. And I really want to get into that to start off. Let's just start with the concept of debt, because I think you know, we all have a perception that we know what it is, and particularly in this country, and I think probably perhaps more so now across the globe, there we all have this sort of specific notion of that it's a moral obligation. And then, but it's also to do with finance, and we things get conflated. And I think the most important thing about your book is to really that it attempts to unwind these strands of the sort of braided notions that come together in debt. Explain to us what is debt.
Well, the conclusion I finally came to in writing the book is that debt is, it's a promise. It has no greater moral standing or less moral standing than any other promise you might make. It's a very peculiar type of promise because it's been made impersonal and transferable. That is to say, well, if I promise to do something to you, you can't really pass that promise to someone else. Now, so then I ask, well, what is it that makes a debt a promise that's transferable? How is that possible? And historically, it seems to be two factors, the confluence of math and violence. On the one hand, you can exactly quantify what's required. On the other hand, you have some sort of structure in place to force people into going along with it. And debt, in the sense that we would recognize it, money in the sense that we recognize it, really is more a product of relations of violence, of war, of coercion, than it is of what we usually think of as peaceful trade.
And so, in other words, we have a situation where we all know the concept of debt as in, like, you know, or promise, you know, I promise to meet you at 5 o'clock. And that's not something that you could transfer to someone else. It has no value.
Yeah, I can't give you somebody else's promise to meet me. And the other thing is, it's renegotiable. If something comes up, I promise to meet you at 5 o'clock, and you know, there's a general strike, the trains aren't running. Something, you know, you can always renegotiate a promise. Debts, because they become impersonal, because they get corrupted by mathematics, you can't, or the idea is that you really ought not to do so. And that has tremendous effects, because it means that a promise that's measured in money, a debt, tends to get treated as totally different, and somehow morally higher than a promise that you make to someone you love, or a promise that a politician makes to the people of the country who elected them.
Now, I want to talk about that sort of the moral ascendancy of a financial debt, even over one of, you know, that people make arrangements with each other. I mean, people make promises all the time. I promise to love you for the rest of your life and to be your husband and wife, and we have divorces all the time.
And those promises are explicitly sacred. You know, they're sacred vows, except people break them.
And so what, now, in, you know, from an anthropological perspective, do we know which preceded, I mean, what was the impetus of this? Because, in other words, you talk about how in the book, how and like you said, debt becomes sort of like the nexus of math and political violence in some way. What preceded which? In other words, was it the idea of, like, was it people who were owed stuff want to be able to enforce it, so we need to change debt into something that can be calculable?
Well, this is a really interesting question, and it's really the question of how does money come about? We were all taught this story. You know, once upon a time there was barter, and people used to sit around saying, tell you what, I'll give you 20 chickens for that cow. You know, eventually this becomes inconvenient. They have to invent money. In fact, as any anthropologist can tell you, this is nonsense. We've never managed to find a society anywhere in which, you know, everyday transactions took that form. And the reason is obvious. The whole barter myth is based on, you know, what an economist would call the spot trade. I give you this, you give me that, we walk away. If you're talking about a Neolithic village somewhere, these people are your neighbors, right? So, you know, if I say, I'll give you 20 chickens for that cow, I mean, even imagine this happens. And he doesn't need chickens right now. According to economists, the deal is off. In fact, you're his neighbor. You know, it's great to have your neighbor in your debt. So you'd say, no, no, come on, take the cow. It's on me. Don't even think about it. And now he owes you one. So you have, this is what you find. You find in ordinary societies about money, everybody has sort of debts to everybody else. And they're not exactly quantified because there's no reason to do so. So the question is, you know, how do you get from that to the point where you can say 27 of these equals 5 of those, which is what you get money, this sort of exact measurement of debt. Now, what seems to be the case is that it happens exactly in situations where somebody is actually committed violence. Say some people get in a fight and somebody cut off. Often law codes and society, even societies about markets, will have very detailed lists of, like, you know, if somebody damages someone's eye, that's 27 heifers. If somebody damages someone's ear, that's 32, and so forth and so on. And that's exactly the kind of situation where you do want to figure out, well, first of all, people are at least willing to compromise and be generous with one another. It's like, no, I demand 32 heifers or this means war, right? And second of all, where they might not have heifers, so you have to substitute something else. So, in fact, that's where money seems to emerge, as this way of measuring debts that you owe for violence, so compensation, fines, things like that.
And so
it starts out.
So I'm sorry. So I want to make this clear because, you know, we have this perception of, like, you know, this debt, this whole notion of debt society and the people getting into debt is a somewhat recent phenomena that is destroying and it is somehow immoral. There's some type of moral connotations about creating debt.
Oh, we shouldn't be in debt. Yeah.
but in fact, debt even preceded the notion of money.
Absolutely, yes. I mean, a sense of having some kind of moral obligation, owing somebody something, now that goes way back. The idea that you can exactly figure out how much and that you can pay it off. In fact, in a lot of societies, debt is considered the essence of morality. It's only right that everybody should owe each other something. So that, for example, this is true whether in African societies, many African societies, or even in medieval England, it was considered wrong to cancel out the debts, because then you're saying, like, well, nobody really needs each other or wants to have anything to do with each other. So if somebody gives you a present, you want to give something back. You want to give something a little bit more valuable or a little bit less valuable than what they gave you. Because if you give something exactly the same, you're saying, I don't even see you anymore.
Yeah, in fact, you and then you also, in the development of money, you also discussed sort of the precedent of essentially money being a function of war, and it, in fact, that debt that continues the circulation of money that the king would give to the military money.
Ah, yes, it's clients. Yeah.
Explain this, that dynamic of taxes and military, and how, in some ways, the government must always be in debt for money to have any value.
Yes, well, it's very, this is a long story, but basically, you know, first you have these credit systems. They're quantified, but they're still credit systems, so you can cancel the debts periodically, which they used to do all the time in ancient Mesopotamia and ancient Judea. Now, then coins come much later. Coins come basically to pay soldiers because, first of all, you know, soldiers are the people most likely to be carrying our little tiny bits of loot, gold and silver, that can break it up. Second, the people you'd least like to extend credit to because they're heavily armed and kind of just passing through. But kings found, okay, we'll take little bits of gold and silver, we'll stamp our picture on them, give them to the soldiers, and then say, okay, everybody in the kingdom has to give me one back again. Now, this doesn't make any sense if gold and silver just sort of naturally money. You just grab the mines, right? And kings would do that. But so why demand taxes, you know, in gold and silver. Well, it's the easiest way to basically employ your entire population feeding the soldiers, which was a big problem in antiquity. How to get, if you have 50,000 people, how to get food to them. So money, cash markets that operate on coins, tend to occur around where armies are for much of human history. And they're basically part of military operations. Armies go out and get slaves, they put the slaves in the mines, the mines get like more gold and silver, the kings stamp it and give it to soldiers, so forth and so on. Okay, so you have that. Now, that connection between money and war is one of those sort of phenomena that runs throughout history that we never like to really talk about. So you have this story that they're supposed to be opposed. You know, this comes from the 19th century. They had this idea, well, there's these old feudal kings and they were violent and they... And then we have the merchants, and the merchants are where money comes from, and they're into, that's the domain of free contract and the free market, and these are opposed principles, market versus state. It's, if you look at what really happened in history, no, markets tend to be created by states in order to feed armies. And this is still the case. Modern money, actually, it's paper money, but it was created, the first example of it really is 1694. A bunch of merchants in England lend money to the king to fight a war, pay his soldiers. And he said, okay, you can take that money I owe you and lend it back to other people. Take the debt, basically, and lend it to people in the form of paper money, which is what British money is. It's the king's debt to the merchants circulated to other people. It actually even says on it, a British bill says, I promise to pay the bearer at £10, and then it has a picture of the queen. So if the king or queen ever paid back the debt, there would be no money.
Yeah, okay, let me just stop you here for a second, because let me just stop you here, because this is very dense stuff, I think, and I just want to walk people through this a little bit, because it's fascinating. Just to be clear, the bankers would lend the king money, and the king would essentially give them IOUs, which became cash money. And the king would say to the bankers, lend this money out. And so then the people would have these little IOUs from the king.
From the king.
And this is how they would exchange it. And some people would send that back to the king, ultimately, in the form of taxes.
Exactly. And that's what makes the system work, because the king can say, well, it's a debt for me. And then say, well, what do you get for it? Well, you can cancel it against your debt to the king, which is taxes.
And really, but at the end of the day, the king is sort of holding somewhat of the bag in a way, because if they were to pay off, or someone is, the bag keeps sort of moving around. But if someone was to pay it off, it would essentially pull all those notes. And so that's why, as a government, we need a certain amount of debt. Yes?
Precisely. And in fact, we ran into this a couple times in American history, under Jackson and under Clinton. This is Andrew Jackson tried to pay off the U.S. debt, the Revolutionary War debt that everybody's complaining about. Again, sort of moral, we shouldn't be in debt. He got rid of it. He got rid of the central bank and, created this giant financial panic. So they had to go back to the debt again. Same thing under Clinton. He was running budget surpluses. Everybody's saying, it was so virtuous. He was like gradually going to get rid of the U.S. debt. In fact, it now turns out that everybody panicked because they did projections. And they discovered that, if there was no debt, the economy would collapse. Even people like Alan Greenspan were saying, we have to have a deficit. And he couldn't admit it because, that would be a sort of lefty Keynesian interpretation that money is actually government debt and it's necessary. So he said, we can't have a budget surplus because if there's too much money floating around, the government's got to use it to buy something. So they're just going to start buying up the economy and we're going to end up being communists.
Right.
That was his law. But in fact, what he was thinking is, no, if there's no government debt, there's no money. That's what money is. Money is circulating government debt.
And so sort of jumping forward, what of the fears that people talk about? What do you make of the fears that people talk about that we have too much debt as a government, that we must the number one crisis we have is the deficit, that the idea of borrowing, of the government being this far in debt, is slowing down the economy and it's extracted this money from the private markets?
Right, that's the line. And it is true that if you know, there's government debt circulating around. It means the banks don't have to produce all the money themselves. That's the other great secret. Every system bank makes money. They are granted this monopoly in making up money. Now, the problem with this is, first of all, it's backwards. If there was, you know, no deficit at all, it would be much greater disaster than having too much deficit. If you have too much deficit, you know, it can create too much money floating around, and that could create inflation. If last I checked, the inflation rate in the U.S. was not a problem. The reason for that, in turn, is because the inflation only just really starts kicking in when you have full employment. And our big problem is that we have huge unemployment. So it's just insane from any sort of classical economic terms. Now, of course, people in power can buy economists and create economic schools, which will say that whatever they want to do is right. And that's what's going on here. But, you know, serious economists see them, don't think this is nonsense. You know, the idea that the debt is our big problem in a place time when we have nearly 10% unemployment is just insane. What's going on, I think, is, again, the moral card. You know, you can always, debt and morality are seen as the same thing. You can always appeal to people's sense that there's something terribly morally wrong by saying, oh, the government's spendthrift, we're in debt, this is going to affect our children. It has nothing to do with the way the economy actually works.
Now, let's talk about this idea, which I also found fascinating in your book, that, and because I have many arguments with economic libertarians about this, the idea that the government is interfering in the market, and what we want is fully free market as possible, envisioning this, you know, getting back to that market that exists in nature before a government comes and corrupts it. But in fact, that never existed, did it?
Absolutely not. I mean, markets, the way they think of them anyway, have been historically created by governments, usually as a side effect of military operations. And occasionally you do get periods of history in which markets sort of float free of governments to a certain degree. But even there, it's under very unusual circumstances, and the markets start looking extremely different than the kind that the libertarians are thinking about. The greatest example that I give in the book, and this is one of the great ironies of history, actually, is medieval Islam, the caliphate. Under the caliphate, they did have a free market ideology, and to some degree, they created a free market, which went way beyond the domains of any kingdom. But, you know, they did it through Sharia. They did it by creating civil courts and having the government really have nothing to do with regulating economic affairs. So that, and also by eliminating usury. So those courts banned any taking of interest at all. And arguably,
when you do that, you're really just creating a different government. I mean, you're creating a theocratic structure that is just as impinging upon the market as would a government from that perspective.
You could take that argument. I mean, the difference between those courts and government courts is they couldn't put you in jail. They couldn't actually you know, punish you, other than by destroying your credit rating. However, in a place where, you know, there was no enforcement other than the courts of contracts, your reputation was everything. So you couldn't do business unless you had a reputation of being an honorable person who paid his debts, insofar as it was reasonable. However, you know, the result of the fact that there was nobody to put you in jail meant that the very idea of economics starts looking very, very different. It becomes a matter of personal honor and trust and reputation rather than so profit gouging, the sort of extremely competitive view of what an economy is about sort of also went away because, as I always put it, you know, you can't have cutthroat competition when there's nobody stopping you from actually cutting each other's throats.
Right. So that notion of we're going to protect your factory, we're going to sit here. I mean, almost as if, you know, what we're seeing in the ports on the west coast of this country right now. That situation, you wouldn't have an army, literally, of police in riot gear with clubs and so-called non-lethal weapons.
And that in turn affects the way that you can treat your workers.
Now, all right, so let's move. This is all fascinating stuff, and the implications of all of this, of course, is that, I mean, how did we get to the point where all of these things, because we're told, I mean, you also put to lie not only this notion of the market existing separate from the state, but also the sort of, and the barter and the truck
barter
and the
mouth, yeah.
Adam Smith sort of mythology. You put all this to rest. And at the end of the book, and before we get there, I also, will you also just tell us about the Wizard of Oz? Because I had never heard this before, and it was fascinating. And I, you know, I can't wait to sit down with my daughter and watch the movie again. But tell us about the Wizard of Oz as a metaphor, and to the extent that it was actually meant in this fashion.
Well, nobody has been able to prove it conclusively, but it's so suggestive. And it seems that even by the time they put on the play of Wizard of Oz, which was in 1901, you know, a year after the book came out, people thought that this was what it was about. Essentially, at that time, one of the big political struggles was over the nature of money, whether they had a gold standard at that point. And a lot of it was causing a sort of tight money policies, which was causing debt crises to affect farmers who were being foreclosed on. And the farmers were trying to run a populist candidate to make what they called bimetallism. Let's create a silver standard, because there's a lot of silver mines cropping up at the time. It would make for cheaper money policies. So there are all these debates about monetary policy. And the book appears to be a giant metaphor for the William Jennings Bryan populist silver campaign. Because, you know, what do you get? You get this woman, Dorothy, whose name is suspiciously similar to Theodore Roosevelt, Dorothy Theodore, who is part of this farm family that's swept away by a tornado. She gets transported to the land of Oz, O-Z, which is, of course, the word for ounce. She's on the yellow brick road, which is like gold bars, right, toward the Emerald City, which is green. And the only way out is they change it to ruby slippers in the movie, but it's silver slippers is her only escape. And along the way, she meets the scarecrow, and the scarecrow actually represents the farmers who have no brains because they're always getting these bad debt contracts and getting foreclosed on. Then she meets the Tin Woodsman, who's like the industrial proletariat who has no heart because he won't act in solidarity with the farmers because he kept trying to get the Northeast proletariat to vote with the populist candidate. Then he meets the Cowardly Lion, who are the political class who have no courage because they can't face up to the East Coast and West Coast bankers, who are in fact the Wicked Witch of the East and the West. And you get the idea, so forth and so on. The entire thing is this gigantic monetary allegory.
And what is it that what we learn when the Wizard of Oz is exposed?
Pardon me?
What do we learn when the Wizard of Oz is exposed at that point?
Ah, that the whole money system is flimflam. It's all smoke and mirrors. It's all created by, you know, these sort of phony elites. And the Federal Reserve didn't exist at that time. But, you know, the local equivalents, it's all kind of a scam where they just make up money and you believe it.
But in fact, and you talk about this, money has gone sort of back and forth from being that. And maybe it's always that, no matter between the difference between being virtual credit money and commodity money. Explain the difference between that. And if there really is any meaningful difference in terms of, you know, the intrinsic value of money.
Well, this is actually one of the great discoveries, I think, of my book. And it's to some degree inspired by an anthropologist named Keith Hart, who wrote a book called an essay called Two Sides of the Coin. What he argued is that money is always two things. It's always both a thing, a commodity, and it's also promise, a social relationship. And economists, you know, there's no consensus among economists which one is primary, which one money really is. It's one of the ironies of economics that even though what economists do is they describe a world made possible by money, they don't actually know what money is. There's no consensus. But what I found is that it kind of veers back and forth over the course of history. So in ancient Mesopotamia, basically you have credit money. You don't, coinage is invented much later. So people, in fact, they didn't even make scales accurate enough to measure out the tiny pieces of silver that would have been required to buy like a hammer or, you know, a pair of pants or some chicken or something like that. So all everyday transactions were on credit. They had these very complicated credit systems with compounded interest rates long before the existence of coins. Now, then starting around 600 in China, India, and the Aegean, Eastern Mediterranean, pretty much simultaneously, close to that, people invent coins, which seems to be a military thing. It's paying soldiers, as I was saying. And then it shifts back again. In the Middle Ages, the empires collapse. The coins go away. And you go back to credit systems. That's when they're writing checks. Checks is an Arabic word, actually, in Middle East. You know, you have these credit systems that turn into paper money in China. People are using tally sticks in Europe. So you have virtual money again. Slavery largely disappears. The big empires crumble. And
that virtual money, I should say, that virtual money uses the units that were developed by the physical money just because that's the tradition, yes?
Exactly. And Europe is a really fascinating example of that because everybody says, oh, Middle Ages, people reverted to barter. Nonsense. Again, nobody was saying, I'll give you 20 chickens for that cow. What they were doing was they were using money that didn't physically exist. So everybody was using Roman currency, even though there wasn't any Roman currency actually around. But they're figuring it out. They're making transactions. They're renting things. They're lending things. They're calculating interest, even though that became technically illegal. So they were using and Louis did the same thing. Under Charlemagne, he issued money, and that money just almost completely disappeared immediately. Charlemagne didn't last very long. However, for like another 600 years, that's what people use. That's where pound, shilling, and pence come from. They're Carolingian money. But people actually called it imaginary money. Local kings would create their own currency sometimes, although they were used for very limited purposes. Mostly people were using credit. But all the credits and debts were calculated in this money that no longer existed.